above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. All that you've done for me. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
All right, well, happy celebration of the resurrection of Christ, everybody.
Happy Easter!
Woo! Happy Easter, guys. Why don't you take a second and say hi to everybody. All right. Well, if you guys don't know who I am, shame on you. No, I'm just kidding. My name is Tim Welty, and I'm around. I'm up here, back there. I do stuff around here sometimes. So welcome to Crossroads, everybody. If you haven't been here before, if you're relatively new, you got a bulletin this morning. Inside of that bulletin, you're going to get this handy little connection card. That is... you can fill it out and have your information on there, and you can give it to Bill Rude right here, and he'll give you a little gift for being with us this morning. And if you've been here for a while and you want to fill one of those out, if you got a change of information or have a question or anything like that, you can go ahead and just drop it in the offering plate as it goes around today. one thing that I really love about Crossroads is you, and you know who you are. No, all of you. I love all of you guys. This is truly an amazing church with amazing people. It's awesome to come here every week and see all your guys' bright and smiling faces. Today, it's Easter, if you didn't know. And today we're going to be having our Easter egg hunt for the kids outside after service. So when the service is over, please give us a couple of minutes to set up for it. And you guys can just hang out in here and fellowship for a while. And then we'll get it all set up and let you know. And we can go out and start grabbing eggs. Children only. I should specify that. Children only. I was kind of bummed out, but that's all right. And then next week, we're going to be taking pictures for the directory, so all your bright and smiling faces will be on camera, on photographs, in a book for people to look at. So if you want to, spruce yourself up for a couple of weeks so you have a good picture, you know, figure out which side is the better side, you know, and let them know as they're going around taking pictures. That's completely up to you. Or you could wear a onesie to church like I did once. That happens. It's up to you. And also, Heavenly Help is going to be moved back to next week, so we're not setting up for that. So leave the chairs as they are, unless you want to turn them all around for Casey. You can do that as well. But that's it for today. Will you please bow your hearts in prayer for me as we bring forward the men for tithes and offerings? Father God, we truly love you, Lord, and we just thank you for especially today, this special day that just encompasses all of history, our souls, and everything just depends on this day and what you did for us today, Lord. And I truly thank you for who you are, and thank you for dying on the cross, Father, but Jesus raising from the dead. That is truly amazing. Conquered death so that we can live with you forever. And I just thank you for this service and just ask that it would glorify you, the worship, the preaching, and edify us as your church body. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands and feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still.
Gracious Father, truly we do praise your name. What a blessed day this is as we celebrate the resurrection of your Son. Lord, we praise you and thank you for the opportunity to come together, to worship you, to praise you, together, Father, exclaim your name and praise your name. God, as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the overcoming of death, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. One thing Tim forgot for you that are visitors, he forgot to announce that it's not going to be today until after the Easter egg hunt that we bring out the snakes for the snake handling. So you'll definitely want to stick around for that. No, if you're a visitor, we don't really do that. Although, that would be a great way to freak out the elders. It's interesting because Easter, I think for us as Christians, allows us the freedom to use Christianese language without any explanation of it. We just kind of will throw out it because we have our own linguistics, right? I mean, Christianity, you got the resurrection, you got all this stuff that we just say and nobody really kind of knows if you're a visitor and you don't get it. And we're going to talk today about eternity and forever. And that's something everybody kind of gets, but realistically, that's an amazing thing that we claim, that we will have eternal life with Jesus Christ. That's an amazing claim. And we live in the construct of time, and you may not know that, I may not think about that much, but everything we experience is based on an understanding of these different standards of measurement, time being one of them. We also measure things in various inches and feet and then miles and all of that. So if I were to tell you, I live 45 minutes away, you kind of can get a general understanding of, okay, well, that makes sense. We start talking about things like eternity, that's something completely different. We have other measurements that you may not be as familiar with. For instance, the Scoville scale. Some of you will know what it is. If you're from Texas, I'm sure you probably know what the Scoville scale is. Scoville scale, really, it measures how hot something is. For instance, I believe it's what do they call them? The Reaper, what is it? Carolina Reaper measures 1 million on the Scoville scale. That's pretty hot. Pepper spray that police officers use is 5 million on the Scoville scale. So it measures how much something's going to burn. That's one measurement. There's another measurement that really we're familiar with. It's called Just a Moment. And we use that as kind of a free pass to get by with whatever. Now, this means different things to different people. There's one comedian who speaks of in a minute, and it's very similar use here. Just a moment, really, for a guy, means, okay, this is a finite period of time. For a woman, it's not. Just a moment can mean this indefinite period of time. You're just waiting. But for a guy, that's a finite. Now, in medieval times, just a moment actually was a measurement. It was about a minute and a half. So when you say that, that's understanding. It's about a minute and a half. And there's one final one that most of us wouldn't be familiar with. Now, if you're from MIT, you might remember this called, it's called the SMOOT. And the SMOOT is a measurement, it's a physical measurement of distance, about 5'7". And what it is back in 1958, Oliver SMOOT was trying to get into a fraternity. Well, as one of the tasks, they had to measure this bridge. Well, in order to measure it, they used the SMOOT scale, which is he laid down 5'7", and they measured all the way across. And ultimately, the bridge that they were measuring was 364.4 SMOOTs and an ear long. So we have this construct in life where we get all these finances. So when we start talking about eternity and forever, this is something that's outside of all of that. And it's an amazing claim that we experience and we live in as believers through Jesus Christ. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. We're going to read verses 1 through 12, and then I'm going to jump down and read verses 36 through 49. I will, as you're turning there, qualify today's sermon. If you weren't here on Good Friday, understand you are going to be confused for a large part of today's sermon, because there's going to be something going on up here that you're going to be like, why is that happening? That's okay. That's intentional. You should be confused, but you wouldn't be confused if you're here on Good Friday. So all of you that were here on Good Friday, if you're like me, you'll be sitting there like the cat that ate the canary, knowing what's going on, and you can laugh at the people that weren't here. And when they lean over and say, what is the deal with that? You can say, you should have been here on Good Friday. It would all make sense. But I'll explain it by the end. But it is intentional for you to be a little bit confused. Luke 24, verse 1. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened, they bowed their faces to the ground. And the men said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise. And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping and looking in. He saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened. Jumping down to verse 36. And as they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And they said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why did doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. He took it and ate before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures and said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending you the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." There's a ton of stuff going on there, and this is really when we talk about Easter. This is the celebration. This is Christianity right here. This is when we break it all down. We love Christmas a lot, but really Christianity is useless apart from the resurrection of Christ. He doesn't rise from the dead. He's dead, and we're still lost in our sins. And so the resurrection really is what Christianity is all about. But what's interesting with this is there's this really strange concept going on in the midst of all of this. Because what's happening here is they don't believe him. All these guys that have walked with him, right? They walked with him the whole time. They've been there through the whole ministry. They're there. They're seeing the miracles. They're watching it all happen. Everything goes. And then all of a sudden, on Good Friday, it's all done. What happened? Now, they disbelieve him, and they point this out. I mean, the women, and I find it fascinating that the women went there. They're going, and now this really is kind of telling of how things work in life. You know, the women went to take care of the body, and because they cared. And I don't know what the guys were doing, but I have a feeling they were plotting. What are we going to do? And they're back, they're doing something. The women come back, and they have this fantastic story of these two angels specifically, most likely, are there, and they told them this, guys don't believe them. But then there's Peter, my favorite, the impetuous Peter, who runs and takes a look, and he marvels, but they still don't get it. And that's fascinating to me, this degree of disbelief. You know, I wonder with that, as we go through life, is there something that makes sense to us? How? Because on the flip side of it, for me, I look back and say, how do they not believe this? He told them point blank, the Bible says it, it's all throughout Scripture. How in the world do they not believe what he said? How does this happen that in the midst of that, they're not following and not understanding? How is it this? And I come up with a few reasons why I think that is. You see, there's this expectation, there's experience that we base things on. When somebody dies, what do we expect? We're not going to see them again. They're dead. That's what you do. Put somebody in the ground, you put them in a tomb, that's it, it's done. We don't expect to see them again. So their experience is pretty specific to the notion of really recognizing, no, he died. He's not going to be there. He's not. This can't be. You women are crazy. You're delusional. Which really is one of those things. Like, man, I know women, and I don't tend to think that they're delusional until they have kids. And then for a period of time, they go crazy, and then they get back to normal after a while. But really, it's really, like, we look at that. I get it. I said, but these guys are, no, it can't be. And he pops in. Hey, peace to you. Oh. And they still don't believe. Because this is counter to every experience that they've had. This is not how this is supposed to work. Now, we may not get it, but I don't want to be political. I'm not going to get into too much politics. Actually, I'm not going to get into any at all. I don't care what side of the fence you're on. But a while ago, we had this election for president, right? And the nation elected this guy president.
And as they elected him president, there's a lot of people who were in disbelief. But I remember, I watched along the trail. These everybody makes promises, right? All the politicians make promises. And I watched and said, okay, listen to this guy's promises. Okay, here's the promises he's making. Now, I watched with a grain of salt, thinking most of these politicians are just going to lie, and they ain't going to do what their promises are. Lo and behold, this guy gets into office in the first 30 to 60 days. He starts pounding out these things he promised. And I'm like, and everybody on both sides of the fence are going, what is this? This can't be. And I Donald Trump says, well, this is what I said I was going to do. Now, whether you like him or not, you've got to give him credit for that. I said I was going to do it, and that's what I did. But this is counter to our experience with politicians. It doesn't make sense in the registry of how we process information. So when we get to this point where there's this disbelief for these disciples, and we look at it and we say, my goodness, their full experience of this is that, no, he promised it, but how in the world could that be? And he's pretty specific in his promises. So now I'm going to be taken in. We look back in Luke chapter 18, and taking the 12, he said to them, see, when we're going up to Jerusalem, and everything that was written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. For he will be delivered to the Gentiles and be mocked and shamefully treated and spit upon. And after flogging him, they will kill him, and on the third day he will rise. But they understood, this is a telling point of the disciples, they understood none of these things. This saying was hidden from them, and they did not grasp what was said. And we'll talk more about that statement. But they didn't get, this is so counter to the expectation. Right? Remember the triumphal entry, right? They got the triumphal entry, they're laying down the palms, and these guys want him to set up his kingdom now. Man, we're in. Now think of this, if you will. You're in the triumphal entry procession. You're one of the guys, one of the folks that had to go get the donkey, which didn't make sense at the time. Go get this donkey, and I'm going to ride it. Somebody's going to ask you, what are you doing? And then tell them the king has need, the Lord has need of it. And they're going to give it to you. And that happens. And he rides in, and you're sitting there with this triumphal procession there singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, and you're right there, because it's not about you, right? It's about Jesus, but you're right there. You're one of his guys. And you're looking at this, man, this is great. I know he talked about that death stuff. That doesn't make any sense. Look at this. Look what's going on. You remember, if you were here at Good Friday, we talked about it. Every time he talked about they were going to kill him, they talked about who's the greatest in the kingdom. Peter even rebuked him. We never let that happen. And yet here it is, face to face, right in the midst, right in front of them, everything he said, and Jesus kept his promise. They're going to take me away. They're going to beat me. They're going to spit on me. They're going to do all this. On the third day, I'm going to rise, and then we're going to go on with this story. But what's fascinating is right in the midst of this, as it's coming true, as it's unfolding, they don't get it. And that's the same in many of our lives. This is a very difficult thing to grasp when we start talking about eternity. It's a very difficult concept for us to grasp. But as we go forward and we look at this, there's another reason I think that this doesn't make sense to these guys. You see, their desire was for this to be now. They don't have this concept of what's coming. They don't have this concept of heaven. We want the kingdom right now. We want everything to go well right now because, Jesus, we followed you. I gave up my fishing nets. I gave up everything so that I could follow after you because I know you're the Messiah and I know you're going to set up your kingdom. Their desire was something different than what God had in mind. See, God had something completely different in mind, something far greater than they could ever have anticipated. That was what God had in mind, and it required the death of his son. But that doesn't make sense, right? When I desire something, I want it to go the way I want it to go, and when God says the way that you want it to go is not going to benefit you in the long run. The way I want it to go is what's going to benefit you. But what do we do? I don't want it to go that way, God. That way doesn't look comfortable. That way doesn't look fun. God, that you require of me to tell this joker at work that I don't like, that you love him? I don't think so. You want me to open up my Bible and read it? You want me to pray in front of my family? Come on, that's not comfortable, God. But that's the reality. But the desires of these guys, I think that challenges their ability to fully comprehend. And finally, there is this aspect of they just can't understand it. There's a thing that we look at within the world of Christianity that we have an insight into the reality of who God is that non-believers do not. And this happens at what I refer to as the Christian aha moment. You see, there's an indwelling of the Holy Spirit where He reveals to us the deeper things of God. This is why I can read the Bible and I can have an intimate relationship with God, because the Bible in and of itself makes complete logical sense. If I were to read it and I'm an unbeliever, I can tell you the story of the Bible. I can tell you exactly what it says. But there's a point at which, in the midst of my life, when I commit my life to Christ, where God reveals things to me that all of a sudden, the reality of who God is and the depths of His nature and the depths of what goes on for Him and His plan for my life and His plan for all of eternity, now it makes sense. It's this aha moment. And as we see unfolding for these disciples, in the midst of that, it says they opened their minds to understand the Scriptures. And He said to them, "Thus it is written that Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in His name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you." Jesus had to open their minds. Paul talks about this in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, where we don't see things the same way. This is where Christianese is. That's why we have this other language. We kind of get, when we talk about eternity, I kind of get it. I kind of understand what we're talking about. Even though it's this concept that's completely foreign in a construct that I don't live in, I get the notion of I will forever be with God through Jesus Christ. You know, I kind of grasp that, and it fully makes sense to me. You see, it's because these gentlemen were sitting there, and they don't get it at that time until Jesus opens their minds. Now, no more time do I think it's abundantly clear for the Christian. There are really two times in life when I think God's presence is abundantly clear to us. At the moment of your salvation, when you realize He is the only thing you need. And at the moment of despair, when you realize He is the only thing you need. Those are the two times in the life of a believer when I think it is abundantly clear. There's all types of distractions in the world. But at the moment of salvation, what happens for us is the reality of who we are before God, that my sin has separated me from Him, and it will do so for eternity unless something is done about it. And that's what we talk about today, what God did about it. But then at the time of despair in the life of a Christian, and we all go through it, there are moments of time and moments of despair where things just don't go our way, and all of a sudden we're crashed down and all these waves start hitting us. And it's at those moments that the reality of who God is and the reality of the eternal nature to which He has called us to and put in us to be with Him forever makes abundant clarity. Because it's at those times when all we long for is to be home with Him. But that's a clarity that is given to us from above. That's a clarity that is given to us through Jesus Christ. As He made this promise, He has established it. It was established in Scripture. It's established throughout Christ's entire ministry. But what is the purpose of this promise? You see, the purpose of this is to magnify the glory of who God is. Have you ever thought about why would He pay this debt for you? I mean, I'm looking at you. And I don't know. I'm not really quite sure. There's like a cavalcade of youth group kids. And that makes it even less clear as to why He would do this for you. No, but I like to pick on you, but I had thought that myself because I know the thoughts I've had. There are people that I've hurt intentionally. There are people I've hurt unintentionally. There are things that I've done that in my life as before I came to Christ, and there are even things that I've done afterwards that I'm like, God, why would you even bother with me? You see, the purpose of the cross, the purpose of the resurrection, the purpose of all this is to magnify the glory of God and His love for you. A love that is so great that it doesn't matter what you have done, He's willing to pay the price. You see, what His death brings, the reason we celebrate on Good Friday, what His death brings
is the forgiveness of sins, but that's meaningless unless the resurrection happens. If the resurrection doesn't happen, it's just a really good teacher that died. The resurrection claims to us death has been overcome by the conquering king, by the Messiah, by a holy God. You see, his part was to die for us because we can't do that. Our part is to confess that Jesus is Lord. His part was to overcome death in order to usher us in and offer us eternal life. Our part is to believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead. If you have these two parts, you're saved. But let's think for just a moment of the difficulty of these two parts. You see, we're face to face right now in the Gospel of Luke with these disciples who've walked with him face to face these years, and they're looking at this. They know the promise, and they still, this can't be real. The women come back. You crazy women. That can't be true. And then I think Jesus probably has really good timing. Because in my mind, I envision it's right as they say, you women are nuts. Boop, there he is. Really? Really? That's how you guys are going to treat the women, huh? And tells them, peace to you. So then the men look like idiots. Because they kind of, if you read the Gospels, they kind of do. And Peter's running down, looking in, doesn't know what to do with it. All of this stuff going on. But I think of this in terms of the reality. They're faced with it, and still, it's hard to grasp until God makes it clear. You see, in our lives, it's hard to grasp the magnitude of this love. You see, the resurrection represents to us an overcoming of death. His death represents to us the fact that he paid a price we couldn't pay in order for us to be with him forever. What's interesting with that is a lot of times we don't tend to think of this. And for the most part, in our culture, it's we want to forget. And even in the church, we don't want to talk about hell. We don't want to talk about the fact that you really have two choices. And it is your choice. I can't pressure you into heaven. I can't force you into it. But the reality of it is Jesus talks about we have two options. You see, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's what Paul talks about in Romans. But really, the flip side of that is you don't have to. He's paid this price for you. He's opened this door for you. You have to walk through and you have to believe it. But you don't have to. You will exist for eternity. I don't want to call it live because there's a difference between life and eternal death. Jesus tells a story of Lazarus and the rich man, and it's a story, not a parable. He's telling a story there. And if you haven't read it, go back and read it, but it's just in the Steve Ivey version. The rich man's in hell, and he's being tormented, and Lazarus is within Abraham's bosom, and the rich man's just, please, just put your finger in the water and put it on my tongue. I'm dying over here. It's terrible. The response is, we can't. Even if we did, if we wanted to, there's this great chasm between us. We can't reach. And he finally gets to the point of, then send Lazarus back. Certainly, they'll believe if somebody raises. Go back and tell my brothers so they don't end up here with me. And the response is, even if somebody rises from the dead, they won't believe. You see, the reality is there are people that will not believe this story. They'll not believe the resurrection. They'll not put their hope and faith in Jesus Christ. And God has to, you will exist forever. And God has set a place apart. And it wasn't designed for any of us. It wasn't designed for any human created in the image of God. It was designed for the fallen angels. But you have to exist forever because that's how you were designed. That forever is in your spirit. That forever is in your heart, and you know it. You see, what he's offered is eternal life together with him. And that didn't just happen that happened at the very beginning. If you read through the scripture, what you find is at the fall of man, immediately God has a promise. And he knows how he's going to redeem us. Now, I like to think, this is again in the Steve Ivey version. This is nowhere in Scripture, by the way. This is completely in my imagination, which is dangerous, you know, when you start going in my head. I just think, you know, in the talk of the triune Godhead with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, as they're hanging out, I don't know what they were doing, but they were there in eternity, and Jesus has got his glory, and it's all that's going on, and hey, you know what, let's do something here. Let's make the universe, and in the midst of it, let's make man in our image. Now, the real theological question is when did that fall happen? And I'm not going to go into that. That's kind of deep water for an Easter Sunday. But what we want to look at is at some point, God the Father had to look at God the Son and say, you know, you're going to have to die for them. Now, that would be about it for me. Die for them? No way. Not only are you going to die, but they're going to spit on you. They're going to deny you. They're going to do all this stuff to you. Even the ones you trust, one of them's going to betray you. That's how it's going to be. Are you in? And Jesus says, I'm in. Now, I'm in. Why? Because I love them. I created them in my image. I'm in. And for me, that's fascinating because that starts to speak to the love and the magnitude of this love that Jesus has for us. You see, I think one of the other reasons that they struggle with believing this is because he chose us. One of the things that's beautiful about when I met my wife and we were going to get married, I knew it fairly quickly because she could tolerate me. And I really thought, boy, if she can tolerate me, this is the woman for me, because you know, really that's a hard thing to do. And my mom did it. And as soon as she could get me out of her life, she'd be, get away. Go be in an apartment, Steve. And my wife kind of wanted to be around me sometimes. And I thought, well, that's okay. We just sometimes is all we need. And so I met my wife and I proposed, and it was the terrible, one of the worst proposals. And I'm not even going to tell you the story because it's embarrassing how bad it was. And don't ask her, because she'll say, I can't believe I said yes. It was that bad. But we got proposed. One of the things that's interesting about a proposal and why these are unique things is because what that signifies is both parties are choosing one another for the rest of their lives. And that's the beauty of why we love marriages. You know, well, guys, we go to the, hopefully they have good food. at a wedding, that's what you hope for, because it's all, you know, you kind of say, but I do, you know, when I do weddings, it's fun, because you get, especially when you know the husband and wife, and you spend time with them, it's just fun, because here's two people choosing to be together forever, and in the back of your mind, you are thinking, you fool. No, marriage is beautiful, but when we come to Christ, what we represent, what we see is, he chose to step out of his glory. He chose to walk on this earth. He chose to do the signs in order to testify to who he is. He chose to be betrayed. He chose to be crushed. He chose the cross. And he chose to be resurrected because he chose you. That's the beauty of this life with Christ, this relationship we have with him. And the reality of it is we have this, and we have this forever. Now, how many of you, in all honesty, have wondered, what the heck is going on? Punch the guy in the face if he touches that Rubik's Cube again. Those of you that were here on Good Friday know what the Rubik's Cube represents. I shouldn't have messed it up before I started talking about the Rubik's Cube. Rubik's Cube is an interesting thing. When it's all put together, don't you feel good? So when it gets back up on the stage and it's sitting there and all the colors are where they're supposed to, didn't you just feel nice? Yeah. You're sitting here and says, man, Jason really felt good because he can see it. And he's like, oh, thank God it's put back together. Anybody with any, like I have some obsessive compulsive stuff. And so when it's like this, it really is irritating. And when it's like this, it's really irritating. And so you want everything nice and neat and everything, and we want life like that. And I'm convinced as the disciples were there at the triumphal entry, they're thinking, man, this Rubik's Cube is together. And all of a sudden at the crucifixion, everything's jacked up. Their whole lives fell apart. And for us, when we come to Christ with a busted up, mixed up Rubik's Cube. Now, after my Good Friday service, after the Good Friday service, numerous people came to me. You know how to do that. And I don't know how to do that. Well, you take off the stickers and you put them where they're supposed to be. That's cheating. That's not how the Rubik's Cube works. And besides that, my son decided he would get a speed cube. This is for the Rubiksers out there. How many of you knew there was actually a thing called a speed cube? It's okay. Oh, a few of you. All the kids. And all the kids, oh, speed cubes, that's cool. When I was a kid, you had one Rubik's Cube, and it wasn't a speed cube. It was, and then if you were, really rough on it, you'd throw it, and it'd break. But a speed cube allows you to really turn it fast. And I asked my son a while ago, hey, well, how do you do that? He says, Dad, you got to know the algorithm. You got to know how it's done. And the word algorithm was enough for me as I'm out. I don't have any desire. You're using words like that. That's beyond my comprehension. But he can do it now in under a minute. And that's amazing. And he's got this competition with his buddies. His buddies at school can do it. And the world record is what? 10 seconds? Four seconds. 4 seconds. Some guy can do it. The guy has no life. I don't know what you're doing on a Rubik's Cube in 4 seconds. But now I've lost complete train of thought. But the Rubik's Cube, when it's together, man, doesn't it feel good? But life isn't like that. And we come to Christ, and man, you can be on the clock now. We come to Christ, and we hope that when we come to Christ, what he does is he puts things back together, right? And it feels, and we have this scope and this understanding of what life is supposed to be like. But we live in a fallen world, right? And it doesn't stay together as long as what we would like it to stay together. And we end up with things getting turned and things got. And what do? Well, then we try to fix it. Instead, we as believers ought to understand and recognize, no, if I take it back to Christ and I submit myself unto him, what will he do? He knows the algorithm. He's going to put it back together, or he's going to say, trust me. Trust me in the midst of this storm. Trust me in the midst of this. I know there's despair, but understand I have eternity in mind. And you can't grasp that eternity. You don't quite get that eternity. But understand that that's what I have in mind. And how easy it is for us to lose track of that. But we have to recognize that truly what we do is we serve a forever king. We serve a king who will reign forever. We ourselves will be with him. If you've committed yourself unto him, we will be with him forever. In the midst of life, in the midst of the turmoil, in the midst of things, as your cube gets turned and things start not going right, what we look at is, wait a minute, hold on. I know that this is just a fleeting amount of time. I'll be with him forever. You see, truly what we celebrate today is we've received an eternal life that we will be with Jesus Christ forever. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, what a blessing it is to be here today. I thank you for the opportunity to worship and serve you and praise you. And as we come to a close, Lord, I thank you for the chance to be a part of what it is you're doing. I thank you for the salvation that you've offered us, that you've paid for, that you've purchased with your own blood. And we lift up our lives to you. In Jesus' name.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, the war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broken.
Let's close this up in prayer. Gracious Father, what a blessing it is that you've given us today. What a day we can be joyous about and Lord, sing your praises. Father, it is my desire that everybody here would be forever with you. Lord, that we would all have accepted this free offering, this free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ. God, as we come to a close this Easter, I pray that your hand would be at work in our lives, both here and outside of this place, in our lives, where we live our lives. Lord, that you would be with us there, strengthening us, encouraging us, letting us know, and overcoming our disbelief. And Lord, that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of turmoil and pain, that we would bring our brokenness to you. And God, I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you want to fellowship for a little bit, I think I'm not sure when they're going to be set up, but if you're a parent, what you do realize is that half of the goodies that come home in those eggs is yours. So just remember that.